Coming up on the county line, meet the two candidates trying to earn your vote for Lawrence County District Attorney.
Plus, all your local sports updates are here too. We're live.
We're local.
The county line starts now. Good evening and welcome to the County Line. I'm Ashley Bishop.
And I'm Scott Lawrence. With only 19 days left until the Lawrence County elections, candidates are making their final push to gain your vote on November 3rd. This year's elections include races for a number of city council and school board positions, along with the contest for Lawrence County District Attorney. In tonight's special two-part county close-up, we'll hear from both George Freed and Josh Lemancusa, the two candidates running for Lawrence County DA.
Westminster's own chemistry department is receiving some national media attention this weekend. On Saturday, CBS will focus its 48 hours Mystery News Magazine show on the high-profile case of Kaylee Anthony. The network show will feature Westminster's chemistry department showcasing some of the forensic science techniques used in the high-profile case. Here's a closer look.
Now, I got a good arm, but then you're making an arc. You're not making a straight line.
No, I like the straight line.
The producer, Jonathan Leach, was doing a Google search for someone who had used this instrumentation known as LIBS, or laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy, and came across a paper that one of my students, Mallory Lithwa, had done some research on and had been posted on the internet. And so he contacted me and to get some more information about this technique and then ultimately to find out if we could demo the technique here at Westminster.
Go through some. Let's try it this time and just kind of get in there just a little bit.
They've used the technique actually to analyze the trunk carpet of a car associated with a murder investigation, and they're looking for what they call decompositional elements. So if a human body had decomposed in the trunk, there would be an element signature associated with that decomposition. And so with this LIBS instrumentation, you're able to determine which elements are present in the sample, and that's sort of what we're going to be demoing today on camera.
I did my research and I used the LIBS that their main interest in coming here was, and they found us on the internet and saw that Westminster was associated with the LIBS and wanted to come check it out.
So. I do like it. Yeah, I like it.
You think it's smooth enough?
If you have the wheels right.
Yeah. And they've made our lab look very fancy and very nice.
It's pretty exciting. It's pretty big. It's big for Westminster Chemistry and Westminster, so I'm excited.
Could you adjust that or go through some?
Stay tuned for more County Line. Coming up next, we sit down with Republican DA candidate George Freed.
And we have all the latest Hounds and Titan sports updates on this week's Titan Town Sports.
More County Line is on the way.
Remember, if there's ever an emergency, we meet here at the bottom of the driveway.
And I'll get the emergency disaster kit out of the kitchen.
Once we're all together, then we'll decide what to do.
But what about Fido?
What about Fido? The Lawrence County Humane Society reminds you to include your pets in your disaster planning. Make sure that your pets have identification tags that include your phone number. To find out more about how to protect your pets in a disaster, contact the Lawrence County Humane Society.
In part one of this week's county close-up, our own Adam Pyler sat down with Republican DA candidate George Freed to discuss his plans if elected. Freed says personal experience is why voters should elect him on November 3rd.
Welcome back to the County Line. I'm Adam Pyler. This time we'll take a look at the Republican candidate for Lawrence County District Attorney, George Freed. George, thanks for coming on today.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Now, tell the viewers a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm a lifetime county resident. At age 23, I got on the Newcastle Police Department. While I was on the police department, I finished my bachelor's degree, earned a master's degree in public administration at Pitt, and got my, once I got off the department, I went to law school. While I was on the department, I was lucky because I was able to work many different things. I worked canine, patrol, narcotics. I ended my career in charge of the investigative unit. While I was on the police department, I was able to attend the FBI National Academy, which is called the finishing school for police officers. Once I was injured, so I had to get off the department, I worked at Indiana University. I was assistant director of police training. We actually delivered municipal police training to several satellite academies as well as full-time academies. I was in charge of scheduling and delivering the content of the training. From there, I went to law school and I started my own business. I had a security service where we provided security to commercial contracts from Lawrence County all the way out to Harrisburg. When I finished law school, I taught in China for a year. I taught management courses. And then since 1995, I've had a law practice in Lawrence County, a full service. I was 2 years, I was an assistant district attorney, and I've also been a contract defense attorney for indigent people in Lawrence County.
Tell us about your campaign for district attorney. What is your plan, so to say, for Lawrence County?
The first thing that needs addressed at the district attorney's office is the office needs to be able to get the cases to trial on time. And there's been a lot of publicity about Rule 600 and the cases that have been lost. I have several different ideas that I want to implement, but before we do that, we're going to talk to the president judge, of course, and get his approval, because the president judge basically is in charge of the court system and the county. Our goal will be to get the cases there on time, get them tried if necessary, or get them taken care of. Because of my background as a police investigator, we're going to work with the police departments to make sure that the cases at the entry are well investigated. You make your case, then you make your arrest. You don't make your arrest and then try to make a case. We're going to make sure that those cases are well investigated. We will have, and there's a budget crunch right now, and if I can't have staff, it will be me. Any major case that occurs in Lawrence County, I will be available to make sure the scene is handled properly. I taught crime scene investigation. I taught evidence collection. Part of my materials was used when they standardized the Act 120 training on evidence collection. That's one of the areas I'm strong in. We're going to make sure those things happen correctly. Once we accomplish that, we're going to partner with anybody who's willing to partner with us. School boards, churches, after school programs, nonprofits, because we want a prevention intervention program with the youth. We want to, if we can stop someone, a young person from committing a crime, that's better than convicting them. And it saves the taxpayer a lot of money, too. And we're going to be available for those programs. And as I said, I work within systems. That's been one of my strong suits. I work within the police department. I was able to get much training, more than a lot of people. I work within the system. I work within the Lawrence County system to improve it to the best of my ability. And we will be definitely accessible, that's my step plan.
Now for the big question, George. The marquee case in Lawrence County right now is the Jordan Brown case. If elected, how would you go about handling that?
I will handle that case the same as any other case. That's a case with a juvenile who's charged with murder. When a person is charged with murder, he must be charged as an adult. You have to understand your own legal system. The moving party always has the burden. In every crime, every crime that's charged, the Commonwealth charges you, the Commonwealth or the District Attorney's Office, because the District Attorney is the highest law enforcement officer in the county. It's the burden of the District Attorney's Office to present that case and prove it beyond a reasonable doubt. If you're charged as a juvenile and you're over 14 and you've committed certain crimes by statute, you're automatically charged as an adult. The juvenile or child can then petition the court to have the case transferred from adult criminal proceedings back to the juvenile court. The juvenile system is not to punish, it's rehabilitative. If you're a juvenile, there's not a complaint filed against you, or it's a petition. And instead of having your name, like Commonwealth versus, it would say filed in the interest of, because it's in your best interest, supposedly. And that occurs, the juvenile, through his counsel, has the burden of proving to the court by a preponderance of evidence that he's amenable to treatment, and there are several factors that the court has to consider, and I'm sure there'll be expert testimony. And then it'll be the court determination as to whether Jordan Brown or any other juvenile similarly situated is going to be tried as an adult or tried as a juvenile. And that's how every case has to be handled. And, you know, it's interesting because if you know the standards of proof beyond a reasonable doubt, the way to look at it would be on a football field, you get the ball down to your opponent's 20. A preponderance of evidence would be he has to cross the 50. So his attorneys, through counsel, he has to prove that he's suitable for transfer by a preponderance of evidence.
And it says here you were assistant district attorney for 2 years. How does that help you if elected for the district attorney spot?
Well, it's just hands-on experience. I mean, I did, I believe I did 24 jury trials in 2 years. I picked juries in Lawrence County. I know how to pick a jury, and that's a big, big important factor when you go to trial. We know how to prepare our witnesses. We prepare our witnesses thoroughly. It's just been hands-on experience, and I was very successful when I did trials. In that 2 years experience, we did not only trials. I had the famous hamster case, the summary appeal. Okay, I know the system from top to bottom, and I did an arson case. We did a attempted homicide case. We did aggravated assaults. And we did there was hamsters for the Humane Society that were left in an old pet store. So we've run the gamut, and we have a lot of experience there.
Well, George, thank you for coming on today, and good luck November 3rd.
Thank you for having me.
And we'll be back with more County Line right after this.
Stay tuned. Part two of this week's County Close-Up is next. We'll hear from Democratic District Attorney candidate Josh Lamancusa about his run for election.
Following that, we have all the local sports highlights. More County Line is on the way.
Everyone should have a plan for what to do if disaster strikes. And if you have pets, you should have one for them too. Always have up-to-date identification on your dog or cat. Keep current color photos of your pets with the rest of your emergency supplies. If you know danger is coming, get your dogs on a leash and your cats in a carrier as soon as possible. Remember, your pet is safest when it's with you. This message brought to you on behalf of the Lawrence County Humane Society.
There's a better way to have fun with history. Visit americaslibrary.gov. Log on, play around, learn something.
On part two of this week's County Close-Up, our own Adam Pyler sits down with Democratic District Attorney candidate Josh Lamancusa.
Lamancusa discusses running under his four-point plan, which involves tackling tough issues in Lawrence County, in this week's County Close-Up.
Welcome to the County Close-Up. I'm Adam Pyler. Today I have the opportunity to sit with the Democratic candidate for District Attorney, Josh Lamancusa. Thanks for coming on today, Josh.
No problem.
Now, to start, tell us a little bit about yourself.
I'm a former member of the United States Navy Judge Advocate General's Corps. This is my 11th year of criminal litigation experience. When I was in the service, I began my career as a prosecutor, and I was stationed at Naval Station Norfolk. Norfolk is in Virginia, and it's the largest military base in the world. Approximately 150,000 military personnel and their dependents are stationed there. I began my career handling some of the smaller cases. A Marine would beat someone up in a bar, or a sailor wouldn't show up for work, but I quickly moved up through the ranks and When I left Norfolk 3 years later, I'd been placed in charge of the entire office. I ran the largest military prosecution office in the world, consisting of 11 full-time prosecutors, 4 paralegals, a civilian support staff, almost twice the size of the current office that I'm running for. I also handled all of the Navy's child sex abuse cases, adult rape cases, death cases, and child pornography cases on the East Coast, into Europe, and into Southwest Asia. I would frequently travel overseas to investigate a case, bring it back to the United States, and try it to completion. When I left Norfolk, I then went to Naples, Italy, which was a great duty station. So for everyone who paid your taxes, thank you very much. I appreciate it. I got married there, and I was also placed in charge of 2 divisions. I ran a claims division consisting of 4 branch offices, and these offices were located in various countries throughout Europe. I handled a budget of a little over $650,000. And then I also ran a defense division, which again had 4 branch offices in different countries. I did that for a little over 2 years and then came back to the United States, where I began to work with my father for the last 4 years.
Okay, now it's time for a little tougher questions. Could you explain in detail, please, your plan you have for the community if elected into the district attorney's office?
I have a 4-point plan that I would like to implement. The first point is there has to be an expansion of the Lawrence County Drug Task Force. Right now, there are only 2 undercover agents working full-time narcotics operations within our county. That's too few. What we need to do is expand the task force so that it reaches out into every township and borough. We can do that through training individual officers to take on a narcotics role within their township, within their borough. This can be done through training through the federal government, through the state. Also, the program itself is self-funded. All of the assets that we seize from these drug dealers, they can then be forfeited and can be channeled right back into the program to support further operations. My second program is a program called Courtrooms to Classrooms. It's an education program. I've had an opportunity to meet with 5 of the 8 principals already, and they've really been enthused about the program. What it does is it gives children an opportunity to have access to the criminal justice system, because right now the only time I see a child is when they're a defendant or a victim, and that should not be their only exposure. The program itself offers a mock trial program, a moot court program, after-school employment opportunities for some underprivileged children within the community. It also gets attorneys into the school systems to teach civics and to talk about any other law enforcement related issues. The third program is a neighborhood watch program, and that program gives communities the opportunity to start their own neighborhood watch if that's something they're interested in. I don't believe it should be forced upon a community to have a neighborhood watch, but they should have the opportunity to have a program run successfully. I've been to over 50 of these neighborhood watch programs, and they're all run differently. There has to be some sort of coordination between them, and I currently have 2 officers in place who are willing to go out and train the citizens on how to run an effective program. The final point of my platform is to hire a humane officer. This would be done through grant money, so it'd be at no additional expense to the community, and that humane officer would be dealing with animal neglect issues throughout our community. This would take some of the burden off our local police officers so that they could perform the duties that they have truly been hired to do.
Now let's go back to your neighborhood watch point. Is that in effect to the fires that's been going on in Newcastle?
No, it is not. As I said, I've been to over 50 of these, and the communities throughout our county are crying out for these programs. They are taking a more active interest in policing themselves, and they're taking more active interest in the community itself, and they want to know how to run one of these programs.
Now, if elected, how would you handle the Jordan Brown case? Are you looking forward to it, or what's your stand on that?
I get asked that question all the time, and to be honest with you, I do not know a whole lot about the case other than what I've read in the newspapers. I don't have access to the police investigation, to the psychologist or psychiatrist reports. I just don't have access to the file, so at this point in time, I can't really give you an honest answer as to how I would handle it.
Very understandable. And now it says here you manage the largest military prosecution office at the world's largest military base. How does that help you in your candidacy for the district attorney's office?
Well, it basically is a job that I've done before. I was a district attorney, although we didn't call it a district attorney. In the military, it was called assistant chief trial counsel. And I was responsible for the supervision of thousands of cases and all of the cases of my prosecutors. So in effect, this is a job that I have already done before.
Okay, Joshua, thanks for coming on today. We'll look forward to seeing you when election time comes. More County Lines up next.
Thank you.
Good evening, sports fans, and welcome to your home for Westminster and Wilmington sports news, Titan Town Sports. I'm Matt Ogden. The Wilmington Greyhounds were looking to recover from their homecoming loss 2 weeks ago. They traveled to Sharon to take on their rivals, the Tigers. Titan Town Sports reporter Ryan Hitchcock has all the highlights from this past week's action.
This week, the Hounds go up against the Sharon Tigers, and it is just a little bit of a muddy field and a rainy day, but hopefully they can come out with another win. Last week, they lost against the Hickory Hornets. This week, they're hoping to defeat the Tigers for their homecoming. Let's find out and see what happens. Here comes the kick of the game. Hounds are the first team to receive the ball. Whiting runs down the field, gets to about the 30-yard line, but the Hounds are stopped. No points scored in the first quarter, but in the second quarter, the Hounds make a good drive towards the end of the field. The Metal runs the ball down the field. No one open, but he makes a break for it. Gets to about the 45-yard line, almost into the Tigers' territory. One more try. Fakes the handoff to Whiting, but Fillion breaks in through the middle for some good yardage on the play. Hounds are creeping into Sharon territory as DeMetal whips the ball to Burns, who then jumps over a Sharon player and then dodges another, gets taken down at around the 40-yard line. DeMetal has the ball, no one to throw to, but breaks through the middle again for another 15 yards. DeMetal hands the ball off to Fillion, who gets through the center and runs into the end zone for the first touchdown of the game. Hounds are up 7-0 in the second quarter. DeMetal looks, runs right through a hole, finds an opening, and gets down towards the end zone. With only seconds remaining in the second quarter, the Hounds line up to make a field goal, but the Sharon Tigers were offsides, so they had to kick again. This time, they kick it, but the kick is no good, which means the Hounds will still be leading by 7 going into the second half of the game. Sharon has possession of the ball in the third quarter as they wind up and throw it to an open man, getting them plenty of yards and plenty closer to the end zone. Well, it seemed to work for the Hounds, and the Sharon Tigers decide to do a quarterback sneak into the end zone for a touchdown, tying up the game 7-7 in the third quarter. The Hounds aren't quite done just yet as Whiting plows through the defensive line and gets into the Tigers' territory, closer and closer to that goal line. The Hounds switch sides of the field at the start of the fourth quarter. Metal hands the ball off to Whiting, finds a hole on the outside and gets close to the goal line, but is taken down inches short of a touchdown. Metal hands the ball to Fillion, who piles up in the middle but gets the touchdown for the Hounds, making it 14-7 in the fourth quarter. I'll tell you what, Jake DeMetal must have bought a brand new pair of shoes because he runs again down the field and escapes the Sharon Tigers for nearly 50 yards, getting close to the 20-yard line, getting the Hounds close enough so Whiting can make another run into the end zone, giving them another touchdown and the final touchdown of the game, making the score Hounds 21-7 against the Sharon Tigers. Be sure to look for another Hounds roundup next week as the Hounds play at home against Reynolds High School. I'm Ryan Hitchcock for the Hounds Roundup.
Hounds' 2-touchdown victory puts them at 5-1 overall for the season and 3-1 within District 10 play. Hounds look to make it 2 in a row when they host the Reynolds Raiders tomorrow evening. Titans were looking to shake off their last-second loss to Teal when they hosted the Waynesburg Yellow Jackets this past Saturday to celebrate homecoming. And if you thought last week was exciting, this past Saturday's game was that and then some. To the highlights.
We pick it up in the first with the Titans up 7-0 until Brad Dawson slings it 52 yards to his wideout Bobby Francis for the score, evening it up 7-7. In the second, the Titans found themselves down a score and they're reaching into the bag of tricks for the flea flicker. Lee Hockey gets slammed to the ground but would find none other than John Gubisch for a 35-yard score, 14-all. Again in the second, the Titans are down another score and they're not going to need any tricks, just some fancy footwork from Gino Pasquinelli in the back of the end zone. What a catch, knotting it up 21-21. To the third now, Dawson looking deep again, and this time he would find Brett Heckle beating the coverage for a 62-yard score, giving the Yellow Jackets the early second half lead. After a Titans score in the third, not even 2 minutes into the fourth, Lee Hockey, who got a majority of the snaps in the game, finds lucky number 13 Goobs, who would drag a defender into the end zone to give the Titans a 35-28 lead. Later in the fourth, the Yellow Jackets were looking to even up at 42 apiece when Dawson would find tight end Zach Fedegante for 38 yards, which would lead to this one-yard scamper from Dawson, his second on the ground and his fifth overall on the day to make the score 42-all. From 37 yards out, Trevor Young's kicking it for the game, and it's no good. Since regulation couldn't finish this one, we're going to OT. After a Titans score, Dawson is looking for one himself, but Corey Meeker's thinking pick, and the Titans pulled off the upset 49-42, Westminster's homecoming.
The Titans' victory over Waynesburg puts them at an even 2-2 in the PACs. The Titans score off against the Bison when they travel down to Bethany College on Saturday. Other Titans sports, the ladies' Titans volleyball team traveled to Chatham College Tuesday night to take all three matches in straight sets. The ladies travel to St. Vincent and are in action this evening. The men's soccer team lost in OT this past Monday evening when they hosted the St. Vincent Bearcats. The men look to regroup and improve to 7-8 overall when they travel to Geneva tomorrow evening. The women's soccer team has been playing well as of a late win in their past two games, including their 2-0 win over St. Vincent Monday. They look to make it 3 straight when they will also be traveling to Geneva tomorrow. And starting off with 10 straight wins, the women's tennis team has been continuing their terrific play as they took down another opponent, the Geneva Golden Tornadoes, last night, 8-1. This puts the Skirts at 12-2 for the season, taking down opponents in and out of both their conference and division. The team is preparing for the PAC tournament coming up next week, and Titan Town sports reporter Matt Parisluka caught up with the team to see what has inspired this spectacular season.
Well, the girls just took care of themselves, actually. They just played very hard. They were very focused on the schedule, and we just played them one match at a time. And I know that sounds like a cliche, but, you know, really there was little to no motivation from my part. It was just the players, and they just wanted to do well. We've completed our President's Athletic Conference schedule. We're 6-1, I believe, and we will be second, but we play a flight to tournament, so we'll have 9 flights coming down. The team standings have no relevance to the tournament whatsoever. It's just nice to have a nice record going in. We have 13 players, and anytime you have 13 young ladies that want to compete and are willing to come in a week early and work on their game and continually work hard to compete, that's a good sign. You know, we're just very fortunate that we have 13 very fine players that are good students, that are good people. They like each other, they've meshed well together, and that's the success we've had. The girls really like each other. A win is a win, a loss is a loss. Hopefully we'll get better from it. This is going to be high quality competition, and you know, they're a very good team. They've had a very, very strong fall, and so it'll be a good barometer for us to check out where we are right now.
That's it for sports. Back to you guys at the desk.
Thanks, Matt. Be sure to tune in next week for another episode of The County Line.
In the meantime, log on to WCN 24/7 and check it out for your coverage of the campus and your community. Good night.
Good night.
Lisa, a little clap.